Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, Your Excellency. Welcome to the NYU Abu Dhabi Institute and this special discussion session on museums tomorrow. My name is Mariette Westerman. I'm the provost of NYU Abu Dhabi. I am also an art historian whose academic and professional life has straddled the realms of the university and the museum. And so it's a special pleasure to convene this panel of distinguished experts from the realm of museums and culture here tonight. This panel, just to give you a little bit of context, is a one session in a two-day program of a larger conference called Art Museums Here and Now, in which we've convened a magnificent group of distinguished museum directors, art experts, people from the world of curatorial expertise and the relationship between museums and cities in the region, but really from all over the world. The brief for this conference, and we've had a marvelous day and a half so far, the brief for this conference is not necessarily to talk only about the magnificent museum developments and cultural institution developments underway here. It's also been very much to have these experts from the world over take a look at what's going on in Abu Dhabi and use what we learn here as stimuli for exchanges among ourselves and with a very engaged audience over questions of what museums have been in the past, what has worked for them, what has not, under what conditions they arose and flourished and transformed themselves, and perhaps use that those kinds of case studies and historical perspectives to come to new views of what might be possible for museums in the future. And this is, of course, an agenda topic of great interest to this country in particular. So we're thrilled that you've come out in great numbers. I will just say a few words about the kinds of topics that have come up today and then very quickly go to our panelists, who I look forward to introducing to you. In a way, first of all, I would say, as we looked at these case studies on the past, of the past into the present, as we looked at case studies from Europe and Peru of old museums adjusting themselves to new times, as we looked into the reach of museums into the world by franchising as well as by using technology, the story really was very encouraging, and a lot of encouraging words were said that are pertinent for Abu Dhabi. And that is that we quickly concluded that building museums has always been very difficult, that it has never seemed very easy, and that, for example, when the Metropolitan Museum of Art got started in 1870, the entire world was convinced, meaning the old world of Europe, was convinced that all art was already tied up in private collections and museums. You would never get any of it. It would be a flaming disaster, and of course, 140 years later, we know that the Metropolitan Museum of Art is one of the few truly encyclopedic museums on Earth, with a magnificent range of objects totaling over 2 million. So that was encouraging news, we thought. We also talked a lot about audiences, and I know this is on the mind of many here. Audiences for museums, who will these audiences be in Abu Dhabi? Will they be expatriate? Will they be local? How will their interests be met, and so forth? We've only begun to think about this, mostly by looking at audiences in other places, again. We talked about the benefits of building collections and how hard that might be. We talked about the usefulness and also perhaps the punishing schedule that exhibitions impose on institutions. And there was an important point made, very relevant to the efforts of the Tourism Development and Investment Company here and of the Abu Dhabi Authority for Culture and Heritage here. There was an important point made by the director of the Museo di Arte di Lima that no matter how global museums are, they are also local because they have art that is right there for you to go see in your locality, and that creates special opportunities for museums. And I think that's a salutary point to remember as we think about these museums of very global scope here. Now, we thought, what will we do tonight? Rather than summarize that whole set of discussions, which you'll all be able to catch online, we post all of our events in the NYU Abu Dhabi Institute online in video, so you can see all that. We thought, having these four very fine speakers here, I thought I would ask them to take their very diverse experiences and give us their perspectives on what museums might be tomorrow. And I said they could be quite personal about it, and they haven't divulged a whole lot to me about what they will say, so I will have a chance to be a little bit surprised as well. Let me tell you who these figures are. And first, let me say that one person could not be here. I'm sorry to say that the Icelandic cloud of ash did ground, of course, for a very long time, I think still at this moment, airplanes from London. And so Neil McGregor, the director of the British Museum, is unfortunately not here. He sends his regrets. Neil McGregor, you will all have a chance, I am certain, to see in years and perhaps even months ahead, because he is, with the museum, the lead consultant for the Sheikh Zayed National Museum that's being built on Saadiyat. He is a great advocate for broad public access to the collections and for taking a very broad view of the way objects in the British Museum should be shared with the world and might be talked about, not just as art, but as very important evidence of all manner of historical development. If you would like to hear Neil, it is really easy to do. Neil McGregor has been broadcasting an extraordinary series of radio broadcasts on the BBC, and you can hear them online. He's taken 100 objects to essentially give you a history of the world, the artifactual history of the world, in 100 objects from the museum. They are very, very lively podcasts that you can download from the web. So he can be with you, even as he is not here. Speaking for us, and I will introduce them now so they can then speak in order, each for about 10 minutes. I will introduce them. To my immediate right is Philippe de Montebello. Philippe de Montebello is a professor of the history and culture of museums at the Institute of Fine Arts at New York University. He is probably even better known to you as the long-standing, longest-serving director of the Metropolitan Museum of Art, a position from which he retired last year after about a 30-year tenure. During his storied tenure, the museum doubled in size, renovated significant new exhibition galleries for a wide range of art, including coming online next year, the new galleries of Islamic art. He oversaw the acquisition of countless extraordinary objects of art from all cultures of the world and massively broadened public access to the institution. We will have his view. Next, across the way here from the screen, we have with us His Excellency Zaki Nusebe. I have asked Zaki to speak about the cultural development of the UAE because no one has witnessed it, perhaps more closely, and played a more leaderly role in it from the beginning than His Excellency. Zaki Nusebe has lived in this country since 1967. He was the personal interpreter and advisor, policy advisor to Sheikh Zayed, the founder of the UAE and first president and ruler of Abu Dhabi. He has always continued to play extremely important roles. He is an advisor in the presidential court to this day. He is also, importantly for our topic tonight, the vice chairman of the Abu Dhabi Authority for Culture and Heritage, which has brought you the Cultural Foundation and many of the current developments about which he will speak. After His Excellency, we will have Professor Kavita Singh to his right. Kavita is a professor at Jawaharlal Nehru University in the School of Art and Aesthetics. Her special expertise is in the history of museums and the history of Indian art. She conducts fascinating, in a way, field experiments in that topic, working particularly on the Maharaja museums and the early national museums, and the way in which museum activity happens in all sorts of unexpected spaces. And what the future holds in India and perhaps beyond is what she will address for us. And last but certainly not least, at the far end of the podium, is John O'Nions. John O'Nions is Professor Emeritus of the University of East Anglia. He is one of the most widest ranging art historians I know. He started out life studying with one of the greats of art history, Ernst Gombrich, who wrote that short history of the world and Art and Illusion and all those famous books. He has remained very interested in topics related to that, has published several books on the history of ancient classical architecture and art and thought, and its extensions into the Middle Ages and the Renaissance. But he has been just as interested in what he calls the natural history of art and in the way neurobiology may help us understand how art may have arisen and evolved in different cultures. He also has been an advocate, and this is very important really for New York University Abu Dhabi's interests in these topics. He was the founder of a world art research center and studies program at the University of East Anglia. That is now a full-blown school of world art. It is one of the few such schools that truly took on board in the 1990s the idea that the history of art, as usual, could not remain the history of Western art. So we welcome John here as well. And with that, we'll have about 10 minutes from each, and then we hope to hear lots and lots from you, as always. Philippe.
Well, good afternoon. It's a great pleasure to be here again, having been in this room this morning, where I had the privilege of delivering my real remarks, and having been admonished that I am not here to reiterate these remarks. I will first express my profound admiration mixed with a certain degree of awe at what is happening here in Abu Dhabi. And the only thing I will repeat from what I said this morning is my sense that I feel a considerable amount of empathy with what is happening here, since in a certain way there is real parallelism in the creation of the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York in 1870 and the creation of the museums here in Abu Dhabi, by which I mean that in 1870 in New York, there essentially was no art, no collectors, no patrons, no money. It's a museum that was created like parthenogenesis, out of nothing, out of aspiration, ambition, and the motives that run through the whole of the history of museums, which is, in a sense, the aggrandizement and glorification of a state, the desire for a certain legitimacy that is brought about by having culture of a high order, as well as interest, and you used the word already, of tourism, except that in the 17th and 18th century, all of the people writing, let's say, in wanting to establish the final nature of the Uffizi in Florence or the museums in the States in Germany and certainly the Met, kept talking about, and it will bring foreigners. We use today the term tourism. So not much is different. The other thing I should preface my remarks with is my sense of a certain oddity and irony that I should be speaking about the museums of the future, since I am the person here representing the museums of yesteryear. I essentially have a career that now belongs in the archives. And any vision I have with the future is by definition rooted in the paradigm of the past. And so it'll be a great leap of faith, but then you are making a leap of faith here at the same time for me to try to gauge what the future holds. I will be on occasion in these remarks and sets of rhetorical questions that I shall pose, I suspect, on the one hand, politically incorrect, on the other, provocative, conceivably, possibly a little bit rude. But I have done.
Continue.
There are two exits. The point being that I have been on panels all my life, and I find panels excruciatingly boring if they do not engage discussion, disagreement, passion, both one way or the other. And so since I do not know what the future holds, I will simply set up, in a sense, myself as a straw man, and from which and from some of my remarks or questions, perhaps yielding, along with my colleagues, some interesting conversations among us. The first thing that comes to mind, as we talk about museums, that we talk about museums now sprouting up, mushrooming at a staggering rate in Abu Dhabi, beginning to come out of the ground or almost, is to remind that the concept of the museum itself is a strictly Western concept. It is a total construct of the West, and all museums, no matter where they are, and they can be in the new museum in Shanghai, based on prototypes from Europe. I gave details as to why that is this morning. You can go online and find out why that is. By the same token, in terms of the building of collections, certainly there are any number of areas, such as Islamic art, where we have seen, not far from here, in the supremely elegant building of IMP in Doha, a remarkably fine collection of Islamic art on view. I know how fine the collection is, not simply because I have seen it, I was at the opening, but because I counted at least seven objects that I had tried to acquire and on which I ended up being the underbidder. So on those seven, I can tell you they really are very, very good. There is one element about the museum in Doha and the phenomenon of the Western notion of museums and as what is going to be happening here that is of some interest, because it has to do with expectations, it has to do with the appreciation and understanding of what is on view. And I will simply recount in the two words I had at the dinner after the opening, at which I was seated next to two gentlemen and from the region. One of whom said to me, "I am puzzled." And I said, "And why is that?" And his answer was, "I went through the museum, I saw mosque lamps, I saw mihrab, I saw minbar, I saw pages of the Quran, that wonderful calligraphy on blue, but these are religious objects. Why do you call them art? What is Islamic art?" And of course, the whole notion of objects of utility, whether they be for the cult or maybe for daily life, being turned and being, in a sense, neutralized into aestheticized things is a very unusual thing, and for certain cultures, very difficult to apprehend. And this culture, where we are today, which is not altogether but fairly anachronic, is one for which this becomes a problem, and it'll be interesting to see how it is resolved. The other thing I want to say is a lot of people, and you have read this in the press, I'm sure you read it in the press, in fact, at the time at which the President Chirac announced with Henri Loiret the program for the Louvre, a certain degree of doubt and of begrudging of the projects here. And I want to say, from my point of view, there is no historical reason to begrudge anything. History is made up of cycles, cycles that reverse themselves in a evolution that seems to be, to a certain degree, logical, or the result of cataclysms, one way or the other. Art, let us call it that for now, is a commodity, if I may call it that, which has moved in the past, let us look at the Middle Ages and the Renaissance, from the south to the north. It is the Gonzaga collection that is acquired by Charles I. It goes north. It is Mazarin, it is Richelieu buying up from the south. The Giustiniani collection of antiquities, the Chigi collection, end up in Dresden. And then gradually, the art moves eastward, and it is the Tsarine, Catherine the Great, acquiring with the help of Diderot and of Grimm and others, art from France, from England, the Walpole collection, the Crozat, Mariette, the great collections of France and England, moving eastward. Then you have a repetition of the process with art from the Middle East, from Mesopotamia primarily, and Egypt moving north, as Vivant de Nant with Napoleon brings Egyptian objects to the north. The archaeologist Botta from France and Layard from England move objects from Mesopotamia to the Louvre, British Museum. You've got the Pergamon altar in Berlin, and of course all of the great finds from the Taklamakan desert, the Buddhist objects, Oral Stein, and so on and so forth, moving eastward. So we've reached the stage, then you had partage, sharing of the finds in the early 19th century, and a resurgence of nationalism in the early part of the 20th century, resulting in a great number of national museums creating in the countries that were source of material for Northern Europe and America. And with this nationalism came the passing of a number of cultural property laws. These cultural property laws meant that there was increasingly an interdiction for the move, for the objects to move out of their countries of origin. And we are now seeing a shift where art is beginning to move the other way. It is now going to start moving from the north to the south, from Europe to here in the Emirates, to China, to Japan, to other parts of the world. And this is simply the way the world works. And on that score, I have simply to note, and this is something not to be ashamed of, incidentally, art tends to go towards wealth. It always has. Florence was the wealthy city with all of the bankers. You are wealthy with all of the oil. Russia became wealthy, so on and so forth. And art and wealth have always gone together. And it is not an incompatible marriage at all. And anybody who is puritanical about the issue, I'm happy to discuss it with them. Now, let me simply say, in conclusion, a number of questions, and I mentioned that there would be rhetorical questions that I would pose, and I will pose them, first of all, by indicating that there needs to be a disclaimer, like you see in many movies and many books, and my disclaimer is that henceforth the opinions expressed in my questions are not necessarily those of the speaker. Now, one of the questions can be, how altruistic, how magnanimous, possibly even patronizing, are the initiatives of the Western museums in this part of the world? Is it opportunism? Is it mercenary or is it missionary? An interesting thought. Is there, and I mentioned the fact that a great deal of art was moved from the Southern Hemisphere into the major museums in the major capitals, could there be in the way in which art is beginning to return to this part of the world a sense of retrospective guilt, a sense of a redemptive character to the art going back? A question about nurture, culture. Is there a top-down imposition of art onto people, either indifferent to its coming, certainly not, I think, hostile, but for which it will be unnatural? How quickly will it become part and parcel of life? I would also say that there is a question on the part of a great many people that it is one thing to move orchestras, it is one thing to move people, it is one thing to move the performing arts. All you need to do is to house them and feed them. The problem with works of art is that works of art have inherent risk. Works of art packed, unpacked, shipped and packed and unpacked do suffer over a period of time a certain amount of damage, not all of which is immediately visible, but they are weakened over time. And the question may be, to what degree are we accentuating what has already been in the inner circle of the Western museums with their large number of museums, suddenly adding on the shipping of great many works of art, which I remember, irreplaceable objects, pieces of our history and our heritage that are not being recreated. I exclude, of course, modern contemporary art. That is a forever replenished commodity and it's a separate subject. But one of the question would be, are we going to begin to relax the rigor with which one normally deals with loans? And then I want to talk a bit, I'm not sure about what, but perhaps the slide, this you know and this you know, we basically talked about this. I understand fully what is happening, of course, in placing, in a place like this that does not have museums, but that has great ambitions, and where great numbers of people, it is hoped, will be converging, museums such as those I showed very quickly, but the spirit of economic development, of urban development, and of economic development takes on some strange forms sometimes. And what you see here on the screen, I showed that this morning, I showed very briefly again, is a view from satellite of the bigger city in Galicia, in northwestern Spain, which is Santiago de Compostela, where a gigantic space outside of the city is being used for the construction, the architects are Eisenmann, incidentally, for a city of culture. Now, all of the people, including the pilgrims, this is a pilgrimage site, who go to Santiago de Compostela, go for the great cathedral, go for the great medieval city. Who will want to, in addition, come to Santiago de Compostela for a completely, shall we say, artificial center of culture when they have their own hub in the very bad slide. That's the only thing I could get off Google to show you. Then the other issue, and I think it's the one with which I end, actually one of my colleagues showed this slide this morning in his presentation, is the notion of the apprehension, I'm concluding, the apprehension of art, the shock of cultures, the different ways in which different cultures, different people approach different works of art. There are those who simply approach works of art as part of a destination. You make a record of it in photograph and you move along, and then when you get home calmly, then there is time to look at the simulacrum, the image that you have taken. Then there is another way of looking at a work of art, which is not only necessarily aesthetic, which is the emotional response, as with the response to the kiss of Rodin. I think that's what's on the screen. Yes, this is a different response to a work of art. It can even take the form of a kind of a replication of the object that you are looking at. But what I want to leave you with is a very beautiful image that to me speaks a little bit about globalization, and an Asian man in rapt admiration in front of an 18th dynasty canopic jar head. And I think that is what should remain as the symbol of cultures that meet, conceivably that clash, but one hopes at some point or another will, like a graft onto a tree or a plant, end up creating yet a better plant.
Thank you very much, Philippe de Montebello. His Excellency, Zaki Nusebe.
Thank you very much, Philip. In effect, you gave me some elements of some issues I can talk about, because I must say as an introduction that when Mariette first called me to say, come and speak on these panels, I told her I prefer to come and listen to the experts who are with us rather than talk myself. And then she called me last night when I was in Al Ain trying to go to a concert and said, no, you must come now because Neil McGregor is not turning up. So we have
and
to...
And we'd much rather hear from
now,
you, that's what I mean.
I was very sorry, of course, and as a result, I did not come with a structured presentation nor a PowerPoint, and I apologize for that. But I must say, I was particularly sorry to miss Neil McGregor coming to this panel, because he is the kind of inspiring cultural leader that we hope will be able to help us here in Abu Dhabi and in the Emirates as we move forward with the ambitious cultural projects that we have. Particularly because I was just reading about him and others a very interesting article in the weekend edition of the Financial Times, the Saturday Financial Times, by Peter Aspden, talking about the passage of 10 years on the establishment of Tate Modern in Britain. And it discussed many of the issues that we are discussing here today about museums. What are museums of tomorrow about? What revolution took place in the museums of Britain and, of course, elsewhere? And why is it that cultural revival in Britain today has become such a powerful element for bringing the audiences in? And for those who did not read that article, I would recommend it very strongly. Basically, it was saying that the cliches, when we talk about museums and art and culture, we are filled with cliches. When we talked about culture, it was said in the 40s, the BBC started with its classical program. People thought of culture as a high altar, as a sacred temple that you came to. Culture was viewed as something that only the elites would be part of. George Steiner in the 50s would say that listening to Stravinsky's Rake's Progress made us feel very privileged, very rich, and very intelligent. Well, this is no longer the case. I mean, the article on, of course, the Tate Modern was to explain how suddenly art and culture has come to the masses, and how suddenly more people went to visit Tate Modern than went to visit the Millennium's Dome in London. And the reason is that the whole way of running museums of today and tomorrow is changing. And of course, Philip was part of and an inspirer for many of the changes that are taking place, as well as many of my distinguished colleagues here. So what I want to say is that what is happening worldwide is something that is interesting and that bears on what is happening in Abu Dhabi. This brings us to the reason that so many distinguished colleagues came to Abu Dhabi today to discuss museums in Abu Dhabi. And I thought what I could perhaps do best is to try and put into perspective what is happening here, not so much only about museums and the art collections, but also how does this fit into the general outline, the general strategic plan for the UAE's development, and how does it fit into history, its own history? And if we said that 40 years ago we were to make the New York University, Abu Dhabi, come here and bring all these experts to discuss museums, you would have thought that we are crazy, because then the Emirates lacked the basic infrastructures, economic, political, social. It was a battle for survival, and a survival that succeeded, and succeeded for a number of reasons, but mainly because of the vision of one man who wanted to bring prosperity and education to his people and wanted to follow policies that aim at durable development and that aims at focusing on the interests of his own people rather than on ideological expansion. And therefore, the first thing is to say that what the Emirates have gone through was a remarkable experiment, and it is one that has succeeded and has made of the Emirates today the powerful economic, financial powerhouse that you come to see. The next step is when you see at what its ambitions are. And here again, we want to take another cliche off the shelf. Abu Dhabi and the Emirates is true, is known throughout the world because of the discovery of oil. Its export was only in 1962. But there was a thriving community of traders that lived here 5,000 years ago. There was a powerful society in the desert and on the sea, the Qawasim as a naval power, the Baniyas, in the mid-19th century, establishing a prosperous society within the limits of what they had. And it was only recently that there was impoverishment that led to the conditions that we knew in the 60s. So that is, and even from a point of view of cultural the Sharjah had a tradition of journalists and writers in the 30s and 40s. So we are not talking about something that was only discovered with oil. Having said that, what is happening here today, I believe, is something very important. But again, another cliche is to look at the museums and think that this is a project that is taken off the shelf one at a time. So that you listen about a Guggenheim Abu Dhabi being opened and the Louvre Abu Dhabi being, and then this is an isolated incident on an island that is going to be an island of culture. And of course, in order to understand what is happening here, you have to fit it into the general strategy of how the UAE aims to plan for the future. The UAE spent the first 40 years establishing the foundations for a modern state, a stable state, a state that can play a moderating influence in this region and can work for world peace. Today, the UAE is going into a different phase that is more global. We have the UAE is committed to renewable energy. It brought Masdar and Irina here. It is working on a number of leading projects across the world. Within that perspective, culture is a central part of it, because the UAE's leadership has decided that in order to train and educate its own population, its own young people, in order to face the challenges of the future, you must focus on bringing to them a top education and with culture as an integral part of that education. And within its wider cultural strategy, it's not only a question of building two or three museums. It's a whole issue of bringing literature and music, art, museums, of course, but also working on the archaeology and the heritage, on the tangible and intangible heritage. And this is why, with music, it's developing also, for instance, the Institute of Music in the World of Islam. Again, to deal with cliches. And here we come to some of the questions that Philip has raised, because I think that they are, in effect, very important. When we talk about the development of museums in Abu Dhabi, we're talking about them as part of the general cultural development and educational development of our population. And we are talking about not bringing in Western concepts or creating a Western concept museum. We are talking, to begin with, to look into our own heritage and traditions, to see, you look at Islamic traditions in Andalusia, you look at Abbasid Baghdad and the collections that existed in the courts then. And you look at a number of historical background events that happened across the Arab world and within this region. And when we talk of this region, we also talk of our holding a strategic nexus between India and Iran and the rest of the world. And therefore, we are not looking at a Western concept that can be implanted in the Abu Dhabi or the UAE, but rather we are looking at a way of expanding our own heritage and our own culture in order to absorb that which is global and that is international. And the building of collections, of course, will be is something that is worked at, and it is doable, as you have said yourself. There can always be collections from the international art, but also, of course, every museum will focus on the regional art as well and on Abu Dhabi's art. This is not a Guggenheim New York or a Guggenheim or a Louvre Paris. This will be a Guggenheim and Louvre Abu Dhabi. And so will the other museums. There will be the National Museum of Sheikh Zayed National Museum. And when we talk about Islamic art, I know this is a subject that has been discussed backwards and forwards. And Salwa Miqdadi has written long and academic articles about this, but we will not be able to resolve it in one sitting. But there is art in the world of Islam. And one of the objectives of what we are doing here is to show this. And perhaps the exhibitions that TDIC has organized around the Khalili collection and the Islamic embroidery today is one aspect of what is happening in the world of Islam. And I'm glad that you mentioned Loiret, Chirac, and the polemic that came out in Paris as a result of the first announcement of the opening of the Louvre, because we have lived through this polemic, and I thought it was a very interesting and useful one. Because in the end, every single person who is involved with Abu Dhabi's or the UAE's cultural project has become totally committed to this project because they believe, as cultural and artistic leaders and art leaders in the different communities, that what is happening here is something that is useful not only for the UAE and the region, but is something that is also useful for them in Europe in terms of exchange, cultural exchange, building of bridges, and mutual understanding and compassion with each other. And yes, the art comes to the wealthy, of course. Every great artistic movement, every great Renaissance had patronage behind it and sponsorship behind it. And this is why when we discuss questions, are these museums altruistic or not, or do they come with an attitude of course they have commercial interests. It is not wrong to have commercial ambitions, but I think what every art leader who comes to the Emirates and becomes involved in this project, what is very important is that you find out that they have become totally committed and engaged to this project, like the New York University itself did, like the Sorbonne University in Abu Dhabi did, because they believe they are working towards building bridges between cultures. About nurture and culture, I mean, you know, this is something that can take us very long, but as I said, we come from a heritage that is deeply rooted in the past, that has had glorious moments of cultural renaissance that has seen its dark ages. And it is good to know that what is happening in this region of the world is something that is interesting. And let me perhaps come to an end on this point I want to bring, and we can answer maybe questions later. And again, forgive me because I did not come prepared with a presentation. What I want to say is what is happening in the Emirates is really something that is very exciting. The museums you come to discuss today and the museums of tomorrow are not isolated products. It is part of an overall strategy that I believe is deeply needed in this region. One of the results of what is happening today is we have Indian artists come to have their exhibitions in Abu Dhabi. We have Iranian artists become known through the exhibitions they have in the Emirates, in Dubai, in Sharjah. There is a biennale, I think we are in the 9th biennale of Sharjah. What is happening in this region is very promising, and it is something that is needed because we live at a time when there is more conflicts and violence that is bringing peoples apart from each other. And I think what the leadership in the UAE is trying to do, which is to bring those peoples back within each other, to see what differences and what similarities we have in our cultural experiences. And therefore, I welcome your being here with us today, and I really hope that the time to spend in the Emirates will be also spent in order not just to focus on one or two issues, but to see what is happening in the region as a whole. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Zaki, for you never need preparation, which is why one can call you at the 11th hour and persuade you, which also is not hard. I thank you for, as you had promised, listening as well as you spoke. Thank you. Professor Kavita Singh.
And thanks for the lateness of this session, but we were all admiring the display at Saadiyat Island, which, of course, is the reason why so many of us are drawn here, as one is drawn to a magnet, as it were. Because indeed, while this panel is about museums tomorrow, there is no more appropriate place on the globe to be thinking about the museums of tomorrow than Abu Dhabi, and we've had a glimpse of what is to come in the exhibition we just saw at Saadiyat Island. Now, because I don't yet know what is going to be inside the museums in Saadiyat Island, I currently think of the cultural district at Saadiyat Island primarily as this dazzling collection of extraordinary buildings. And in this, it seems to me that the island is the condensation of a very important trend that has been unfolding in museums throughout the 20th century, in which the museum building itself has come to be the museum's main and most attractive artifact. The spectacular building becomes iconic of the museum, and it is increasingly the building which turns the museum into a destination to which people are drawn and travel from far to see. This spectacularization of the museum building, which has occurred in the last 20 years or so, is now a global phenomenon. And if you want to see how global it is, I suggest you try and look at some of the images of museums in China, which are coming up or being proposed, which are truly extraordinary, like many other museums in the West are. But even when we compare what is happening all over the world with what is happening at Saadiyat Island, I think that the Saadiyat Island's collection of museum buildings is a particularly dense manifestation of this phenomenon. And so this project, in many ways, I think, marks a kind of culmination of this trend we've seen of these amazing buildings for museums in the last 20 years. But I wonder, you know, if it is a culmination of a trend, is it also a kind of a grand finale for a kind of a certain kind of museum making? And I wonder whether, instead of marking the outer frontier of the museum world, the Saadiyat Islands project is not a little bit behind the leading curve. Now, even as I say it, I'm aware that this sounds absurd, because everything about the Saadiyat Island project seems not just contemporary, but it seems positively futuristic. And yet, if we see what Saadiyat Island is doing, we'll find that the cultural district is gathering unto itself some models and practices that have already proven to be very successful already and elsewhere. So it's getting the most vaunted architects, the most prestigious museum names, the most respected expertise from all over the world. And these are all things that have been extremely successful elsewhere and are now being reconstituted here. So in that sense, I would say that the Saadiyat Island project is not really making something new, but it is celebrating something that is already very well established in the world. And so although there is much about the island that looks futuristic, the vision that is shaping this is essentially, I think, a retrospective one. So in my opinion then, what is the future of museums? Or what are the museums of the future? Let me take a contrarian position. Last year, one of the most interesting and instructive museum experiences that I had came to me in Dubai in a shopping mall. Now, this was the Ibn Battuta Mall, which is a mall that is designed to celebrate a 14th century Arab scholar, Ibn Battuta, who set out from his home in Tunisia, and he traveled for 30 years among all the Islamic lands, eventually reaching China. The Ibn Battuta Mall has 6 courts whose themed architecture follows Ibn Battuta's travels from Tunisia through Andalusia, through Egypt, Persia, India, and China. Now, when you look at it, you can dismiss it. You can say, this is a theme park, or this is just doing what all kinds of specialty restaurants do. But interspersed among the decorative courts and the expensive shops that are around them are a number of things that I think we can all easily recognize as museum displays. And these are dioramas, working models of machines made by following medieval manuscript illustrations. There are objects in cases. There are text panels and reprints of vintage photographs. And these displays, cumulatively, form an exhibition that traces the history of Arab science and its contributions to the intellectual history of the world. The research that has gone into these displays is impressive. It is serious, it is intelligent, it is erudite, and it is very well produced. And when I was looking up these displays to try and see who had made them, I found that they were made by a heritage consultancy, which now has made a second version of these displays, which are currently on show in the Science Museum in London. The exhibition is called 1001 Inventions, and it is an exhibition on the history of Arab science. Now, when I was in Dubai, for me to see a museum-type display in a mall didn't actually feel odd or discrepant to me. Maybe it's because the Ibn Battuta Mall is not so unlike many museums in advanced societies that are already mixing commercial and pedagogic spaces. So the mall is actually only altering a ratio that already exists between the gift shop, the cafeteria, and the gallery space that we see in the museums of the West. But the experience of visiting the Ibn Battuta Mall did make me stop and wonder whether I was not strolling through one of the futures of the museum. I'm not suggesting that museums will or that they should turn over 80% of their real estate for retail activities. But I am suggesting that what the museum does, you know, the work that a museum does of combining sensory experience of beauty with the pedagogic instruction of history, creating spaces of wonder, presenting itself as a trustworthy source of specialist information, and housing all of this in a spectacular, alluring architectural form is something that a lot of other places are going to do. And the kind of cultural capital that the museum has currently is going to leak out of the confines of a building called the museum, and it's going to find its way into a lot of other spaces. Let me give you another example from another place altogether, this time from Lhasa in Tibet. Now, I assume everybody here is broadly aware of Tibet's history since 1951, when it was liberated by China, or it was occupied by China, depending on your point of view. During the Cultural Revolution, Tibet's Buddhist monasteries came under attack. But more recently, as China has opened up to tourism, and it has realized that Tibet's culture is a very valuable national resource, the Chinese government has poured money into conservation projects so that the tourists who come to Tibet in search of Tibetan culture actually have something to see when they come there. Joining these efforts in Lhasa is a Chinese billionaire who's the owner of a supermarket chain who has amassed an enormous collection of Tibetan art, which he has housed in his new project in Lhasa, which is simultaneously a museum and a luxury hotel. And you see the display cases in the corridors of the hotel, the sign outside, the banner outside the hotel, which you can't read because the image is too small, says Tibet Snow Mountain Folk Art Museum. In India, where I come from, I see the museum increasingly being quoted by or being incorporated into the fabric of religious institutions. Let me give you one example. Just 5 years ago, a very wealthy foundation, which belonged to a Hindu sect, inaugurated this temple, the Akshardham complex in New Delhi, where I live. At the center of this complex stands this monument that we're seeing on our screens. It's an extraordinary, intricately carved shrine that not only looks like Indian temples from the 12th century, but is actually made with the same kind of technology that was used in the 12th century. There is no steel, for instance, in this structure. And it's all made of interlocking blocks of stone. But this very impressive edifice is part of a much larger complex that you can think of as part pilgrimage center, part theme park, and part museum. So for instance, there is a robotics show and an IMAX film on the complex, which both tell you something about the life of the founder. There is a boat ride that you can take, like Pirates of the Caribbean in Disneyland, which take you past dioramas of the greatness of Indian Vedic science and technology. I don't think there's any one designated museum within this complex, but in a way, every part of it is museumized. You enter through an orientation center that explains the entire curatorial concept of the complex. The planning forces a certain pattern of circulation through it, and there are text labels on all the architectural features like this elephant plinth in which you understand what the themes are and how they have been chosen to fit into an overall curatorial program. So the entire complex is something that is marked as an extremely didactic and directed space, which is always telling you not just that it is glorious, but why it is glorious and how it is glorious. Another spectacular religious site in India that will incorporate museums within the religious complex is called the Maitreya complex. The sponsors of this project are the Foundation for the Preservation of the Mahayana Tradition, which is the largest transnational Buddhist organization in the world. It has centers in 136 countries which teach meditation and run courses on Buddhism. And what we are looking at here is the project that they're planning to build in eastern India of a monumental figure of the Maitreya Buddha, who is the Buddha of the future, who will come to earth at the end of time. This figure has not yet been built, but when it will be built, it'll be 500 feet tall. That's three times the size of the Statue of Liberty. The throne that the Buddha sits on will be a 17-story building, and elevator shafts will go up and down the Buddha's body, taking visitors to structures at the level of his heart and his head. Inside the throne building and inside the Buddha's body, there will be meditation halls, there will be shrines and museums. Now, although this project hasn't taken physical shape on the ground yet, the museum collections are already being formed through gifts and donations. And these include some Buddha relics, which I find very significant because they were donated to the future shrine at the heart level from a museum in Myanmar, formerly called Burma. We are generally accustomed to objects moving from the temple into the museum, from being a sacred object to being a secular artifact. And so when this reverse flow happens, where the object moves from the museum into the shrine, when it moves from the space of exhibition to the space of ritual, it's actually destabilizing our understanding of the hierarchy of values, because the museum here no longer becomes the final resting place and the ultimate arbiter of the meanings of an object, but it becomes perhaps just one stopping place in a longer journey of the object to sites that are unknown and unimaginable today. And this is why I like to end at this image, because instead of seeing a Buddha figure in the museum, as we have done for so many years, we're seeing a museum in a Buddha figure, swallowed whole, as it were. And it seems to me very suggestive of an alternative future of the museum. Philippe de Montebello told us that the museum is a Western construct. Perhaps it is. But as it spreads elsewhere, it can be mimicked and it can be appropriated, and different groups with different perspectives can use its forms, they can supplant its spectacles, and they can appropriate its methods to their needs. Thank you. Thank you,
Professor John O'Nions.
No, I was going to say that you don't need any more ideas because we've had a lot already today, and I think in the last three presentations. But I will try and offer something different in character, which is inspired by this occasion, which is, I think, really important. It will be seen as a turning point in the development of museums. I'm profoundly impressed by the energies, intellectual, creative, and so on, surrounding this project. I know that we're going to see is going to be something unlike, really unlike other things. I should say, just on a personal note, on Mariette's invitation to me, Mariette and Philippe's invitation to me to join here, provided a sort of completed a question mark in my earlier life, because in 1963 I hitchhiked with my younger sister from Istanbul down through Syria, Lebanon, and Jordan, and I wondered why I was doing it. Now I know I was somehow smelling the oil in Abu Dhabi. And now at last I've come and found it and discovered why it was so important. So I'm going to talk about world art museums and museology, I mean art museums, world art museums. I should say that it was in my experiences on that journey, going through all these different environments and seeing the extraordinary variety of art, architecture, and artifacts that really set me going, set me thinking about why. you know, the Middle East is one of the most fantastic museums as a as an environment. And so I'm really trying to, in a sense, repaying a debt, because I got so much inspiration from that experience. Now, you may not want to know what museology is, but I'm going to give you a simple definition of it. It's the use of neuroscience to advance the study of museums and museum practice. And today, I suppose, I'm going to be talking more about the implications for museum practice, but I think it's something that I think may be helpful to people here, and I would like to think it's going to be something, sooner or later, somebody is going to invent museology, if I don't do it here, invited to, really, by Mariette, and because neuroscience is being explored as a tool for enhancing all activities. Anyway, a quick guide to neuromuseology, a history. It was founded in the Gulf by Ibn al-Haytham, was born in Basra in 965. This is really important. This is something which is coming home, because the Europeans simply did not really understand that behind the eyes was a brain which was really shaping what the eyes saw and telling the body what the eye saw meant. And this is an illustration from an Ibn al-Haytham manuscript of his book on optics in Istanbul. And this is the first illustration which shows the eye and the brain integrated. It's of absolutely fundamental importance. And I'd keep that image in your mind when I, a couple of slides later, I'll show you a modern brain scan. Because realizing that the role of the brain in interpreting what we see, Ibn al-Haytham really did profoundly prefigure the great discoveries of neuroscience, which have really only emerged in the last 10 years or 20 years because of brain scans. So the next phase, it's refound in the Gulf. There we are. And you're here, and it's happening. And it's so Abu Dhabi is where it's, and because I won't go into it now, but there are very important reasons why it should have been developed, why, you know, Ibn al-Haytham understood things about perception which the poor old Greeks couldn't and the Italians couldn't and so on. He was really ahead of the game, and I think his ideas do need to be advanced, and this is the place to advance them. So this is a modern brain scan, and I hope you can see the similarities. Obviously, the head is upside down, but it's basically the same thing. And I show you this slide because this is the way, the tool, the brain scan that we use to develop the study of the visual system. Art historians can use it, anthropologists can use it, and people working in museums and people building museums can use this knowledge. Now, the most important thing to get from this image is the fact that the person at the bottom is the brain you're seeing is the brain of Humphrey Ocean, who's an artist who's made many representations of all kinds, and particularly he's made many portraits. And he's, in fact, making a portrait. It's a brain scan of somebody making a portrait, or copying a portrait, actually. And above, you see the brain scans of a non-artist, somebody who's never painted a portrait. And the really exciting thing is, although if you looked at the two people, you'd see them doing, their body language would be exactly the same, looking at the image, looking with moving their pencil. What was going on in their brain was completely different, using different parts of the brain, because in Humphrey Ocean, brain activity is intense in a whole series of areas, whereas in the non-artist, it's really much most intense in the visual area at the back of the brain. And that is because the poor non-artist is really seeing a portrait as a problem for the first time and is looking at it extremely hard, doesn't know what to do with it. Humphrey Ocean has seen many portraits, and so he immediately has networks of neurons which connect with everything he's seeing, with faces he's seen before, remembering the technique he used to capture the that part of the face, the hair and the eyes, the reflections and so on, the pressure of the pen, remembering the emotion which was associated with a particular form, the significance of a raised eyebrow, whatever it is. In other words, he's drawing on a wealth of memories which are there because he's looked intently at things before. And what this tells us is something really important, that if I was to scan all your brains and doing different things, whether it was using, you know, an iPhone or peeling a peach or something like that, you would all be using different parts of your brains because you've all had different experiences. And people in museums need to realize that everybody coming into the museum is bringing a different brain. And this is, so we have to think about a few basic principles of neuromuseology. Now, one of the principles is that the brain is a museum in which all our experiences leave traces of which we are usually not conscious. You see, Humphrey Ocean and the non-artist did not realize all these different, the way that the fact that their brains were different because they'd had these different experiences. And I think we need to know about this and remember this. When you see something, when you feel something, when you touch something, when you hear something, when you every experience causes neurons to move in your brain, to grow, establish connections. So this is why, as you sit here, you are basically, your head is a museum of all your experiences, all your actions, all your feelings. And you don't know that. You can only draw on very fragmentary record using consciousness. But those memories in your museum up here are going to be revived as you walk through a museum, for instance. And if what you have in your museum in the head, you know, responds in some particular way to objects you're seeing, you're going to have a very different response, which is going to be emotional, rational, and so on. Anyway, art museums should not acknowledge and exploit this. That's a basic principle. The brain is a museum, and which leaves all these traces, and people who are designing art museums and filling them, putting an exhibition, should realize this. Now, one of the things that's again discovered about the human brain is that we're born with different areas which are prepared to receive all the faces we see, all the bodies we see. These are separate areas in the brain, including a part of the brain which is prepared to receive all the places we see. That's actually illustrated by the fact that there's an area which responds to all these things and doesn't respond to those things. These are all place-related phenomena. And that you can see that this is why, for instance, you respond to a museum, for instance, because if you've seen something with a colonnade on the front, or if you've seen something which looks like a Gary Bilbao or something like that, your brain will say, yeah, that's, you've seen that before, and that's a modern art museum or whatever. So we need to know about those things which are inherently there and realize that these are structural fundamental. The brain is not an instrument for thinking with. It's basically a museum in which you have a record of all the things you've done and felt and seen. Now, the brain has that property because it is plastic. That is, it is physically reshaped by our experiences in ways of which we are usually not conscious. We all have different brains, and the experience of a museum exhibition can emphasize or reduce that difference. Art museums should acknowledge and exploit this. Now, this is something, I want to draw attention here to something which is, again, really extraordinary. The extent to which our brains are really restructured by what we've seen is the fact that everybody in this room is going to see this line as longer than that, although in fact they're identical lengths. Now, that is true of everybody in this room. It's true of everybody in Europe or North America and so on. What is really interesting, if you, and however much you look at it, however much you think about it, you simply cannot see them as the same length. Now, if you show this diagram to a Bushman in South Africa or to an Australian Aborigine, he will say those two lines are the same length. And he sees them correctly. We do not see them correctly, although we could argue, are used to reading geometrical diagrams, or used to being critical, we're used to reflecting and analyzing. We can't do it. The reason we can't do it is because we spent so much time in environments in which lines which are far from us have obtuse angles at the ends, and lines which are close to us have acute angles at the ends, that our brain sort of says, don't worry, I'll solve your problem. Those lines are the same length. So what I'm going to do is to lengthen every line which has an obtuse angle at the end and shorten every line which has an acute angle. And that's done. You can't stop it, your brain doing that. You couldn't. I mean, it would be if you'd spend a vast amount of time in a desert, I suspect there would be some modification. But the point is, not only does it show how our brains are fundamentally restructured in really, really very important ways, but it shows that we are seeing wrong and the Australian Aborigine is seeing right. In other words, I can assure you, this is a tip of the iceberg. There are a vast number of things in which we are seeing things wrong and they are seeing things right. That's just because we've had a lot of experiences which have deformed our brains. We can't do anything about it. Now, the brain exists, the brain exists to help us meet biological needs. It's driven by emotions. Our response to art is between desire and fear. Again, art museums should acknowledge and exploit this. We only have a brain. The only difference between a human, or should I say any animal, and a vegetable is that the vegetable can reproduce and find food by being in the same place. The only reason why an animal has a brain is simply because it needs to move in order to reproduce and to get food. That's the only reason. So in other words, everything that we do with our brain, however smart it is, in designing computers, doing logical problems, playing chess, we only have those capacities because our brain is there to help us survive in these really crucial ways, very materialistic ways, how to find the right partner, how to get the right food, how to avoid predators and so on. And these are all emotionally driven, of course. You're attracted to this, you want to consume that, you fear that, you avoid that. And we have been told that our brains are rational. The reason is only in the service of the emotions. And if you take a work like this, which is in the museum that inspired the concept of World Art Studies, which is the Sainsbury collection in my university, this image is an image which is frightening, is intended to be frightening. And I should say that Sir Robert Sainsbury, who gave the collection to us, he said, when he was presenting it, he said, this collection is not here to illustrate the history of art. This collection is designed to stimulate the sensual development of students and especially their sexual development. I mean, he literally thought this was gonna, make them all, passionate animals. And that's what he thought was right. He actually wanted, it's a nightmare for people like Philip to hear this, but he wanted the students all to go out and touch the objects. As he used to fondle them in his bed, and he wanted the students to, until the museum opened, he wanted the students to go out and fondle them, as Kavita was showing these breasts in Indian museums, which were fondled, and I'm afraid Sir Robert was after that. But I admire him for actually having said, this is all about an emotional, intense relationship. Another principle, the brain exists to help us to meet biological needs. It's driven by emotions. Our response to art can emphasize a sense of quality that is shared or a sense of different that divides us. Now, different people in different cultures desire or fear different things. They are habituated to some things. They dislike other things. And if you see people moving around a museum, people will move towards the objects to which they are drawn, and they will avoid the rooms which have the objects they don't want to see. And you can modify people's attitudes to art by, in fact, engineering experiences. About 15 years ago, when I was setting up this World Art Studies Museum, I knew Japan had a big art history industry. So I went to Japan through the British Council. I got an interview with senior staff of the education ministry in Tokyo. And I said, what is the education ministry's view of art history education? And he said, well, we believe we have a syllabus. Students, first of all, learn about the art of their local area. Then they learn about the art of Japan. Then the second year, they move on to the art of Asia and Europe. And the third year, they end up look at the art of the whole world. And I said, that's amazing. You know, there's no European or country or America that has such a sophisticated global reach. And I said, how do you teach it? And they said, we commissioned a set of textbooks. And I said, can I see them? Textbooks appear. I looked at them and I thought, all these images look extremely pretty and soft. And I thought this must be some weakness of Japanese. That's what I thought in my head. I didn't say it, of course. I said, these are very interesting, but these are, you show the same artistic traditions, but you show them using images which are all, you know, sort of women in negligees and clouds and things like that, and sort of, you know, very light, soft, friendly things. And I said, why is this? He said, we only have this curriculum for one very simple reason. Japan has a very difficult problem. Japanese people do not like other people. They don't like what they look like, they don't like their art, they don't like anything about them. And yet we have to do business with other people. So these textbooks, this course, is designed for one purpose alone. That is to help Japanese people to love other people. And, you know, they understood, you know, the Japanese Ministry of Education understood what Bob Sainsbury, that art is about a profoundly emotional relationship. This I show you, the Sainsbury Centre, and I say because it makes a very important point that within the Sainsbury Centre there is art from all over the world, from prehistory to the present, and there are no separate rooms where you say, this is, you know, that's the Asian room, or that's the Chinese room, or that's the European room. It's all one thing, because it is really the world. I mean, and architecturally, I think it is terrible. There just are no museums of comparable scale and importance with works of comparable quality which display everything in a single space. Our students literally traverse the globe every day as they go for a cup of coffee. And psychologically, that helps them to feel a community with people in all areas, whereas they've had to go through a doorway into a room, that would create a sense of difference and distance. Anyway, coming to the end, all human being brains are governed by the same biological principles. World art museums should make people more conscious of these principles. I've just talked about a very few principles, but Philippe showed these marvelous images of people kissing in front of a kiss and putting their tongues up. That, of course, is a very good example of the working of mirror neurons. We now know that you can't see something without, if you look at it intently, you will tend to mirror it. And your brain will be making you imagine mirroring it physically before you actually do. And the whole process of, those of you who've done it, the whole process of kissing involves a most intense experience of mirroring of somebody else. And people's relationship with a work of art is very similar to the relationship to a beloved if you're feeling positive, or the opposite if you're not. And it's interesting that his pair of images showed, well, you know, one image was an image of basically love and the other is an image of fear. So he's documenting the operation of nervous system. So at the end, I would say that principle, all human brains are governed by the same biological principles. These principles were first recognized by Ibn al-Haytham. The Abu Dhabi museums should acknowledge this. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Harmon Bardot. I just had a question for our most recent presenter. This is about that line trick with the two different angles, one going outwards, one going inwards. If you change those angles, would it make any difference?
You mean, would it? Well, no, absolutely, it makes a difference. Obviously, the more, if you reduce the difference between the acute and the obtuse, then the illusion is less clear. That angle has been chosen because it's the one which produces the clearest differentiation. You know, the way the brain works is it's calculating all these things and saying, what does this mean? And it will have a different response to different angles.
My name is John Rote. I am the chairman designate of a new foundation which will be working out of the United States and out of Switzerland. And I would first like to thank the New York University very much for staging these marvelous events. It's a privilege indeed for outsiders like myself, who happen to be de passage here, to be able to attend. And also, I would like, if I may, to take the opportunity, a rare one, in semi-public, to thank Monsieur Philippe de Montebello for the extraordinary personal contribution that he has made to the lives of all of us who are interested in the arts, because what he has done is truly fabulous. My question to you, whoever is going to be in a position to answer this, I hope, we as a foundation are starting a new outdoor sculpture park about 2 hours outside New York. We have about 500 acres of absolutely magnificent land, and we have the privilege and the opportunity to try and marry the beauty of the land, beauty of nature, if you like, with the beauty of outdoor sculpture, which we hope to install. And the question that I have is, can you tell us how, for example, with the climatical limitations that you obviously have in this part of the world, how do you see the future of outdoor sculpture in the UAE? Thank you.
The future of outdoor sculpture in the UAE.
I do not see any limitations on sculpture that it can be commissioned for outdoors, but obviously of material that fits to be placed outdoors. One of the things about art, and one of the things we go back to earlier, it does not necessarily be, you know, an amazing art or ephemeral art or art that is there forever, eternal art. Art is becoming different things to different people. And what is important is to make things accessible to as wide a community as you can make it accessible. And this will be part of also the tradition that the cultural developments in Abu Dhabi will bring. I do not see personally any limitations on what can or what cannot be presented in outdoor sculpture in Abu Dhabi or in the Emirates.
Philippe would like to comment as well.
By which is meant, Philippe was asked to comment. Let's get things clear. I'm happy to do so. Thank you, sir.
I accept that opinion.
Very,
yes.
Very much. Basically, two comments. The first is, of course, you are right about the materials being appropriate, obviously. If a sandstorm is going to affect certain materials, if there are sandstorms, I don't know. I haven't been here long enough to have experienced one. But only ash from elsewhere. But the comment I want to make is, and this is something you might even think about a little bit, is my general sense of, it's not so much disappointment, it's sadness at the way in which so many sculpture parks as sort of outdoor museums are created, and all in a sense in a slightly artificial way, by which I mean, and there are several in the New York area, some very well-known ones, and in many other places, I think Noguchi in Houston and several in Europe, is that it seems to me we have forgotten about, let's say, Rome and all of its fountains and all of the public art as being an integral part of life in the cities. Why do we need, not that I'm saying you shouldn't be doing this, but why do we necessarily need to have an enclosed, like a zoological area for sculpture? I realize, certainly living in New York, that the simple reason you could never do it is all of the agencies, from the Arts Commission to the Landmarks Commission would forever vote no to whatever piece of public sculpture would be proposed for a public space. But conceivably, Abu Dhabi is more enlightened, and some public sculpture could take place within the city that you don't have to go to as a destination, but chance upon. And there's so many old cities in Europe where you chance upon art, and in many parts of the East.
Well, thank you very much. In effect, there has been a sculpture, international sculpture workshop that was organized by one of the galleries in Abu Dhabi, Salwa Zidane. I don't know if you have visited. Mm-hmm. Specifically for this, sculptors were brought from all over the world to produce sculptures in Abu Dhabi and within this workshop that then can then be put in the public places in the cities of Abu Dhabi and Al Ain and elsewhere. So yes, I totally agree with you. Sculpture is something that needs to be integrated into community life.
Thank you. We hope to do the same on our campus, in fact.
This is just a question. My name is Tagrid from Suruh Real Estate. I just want to know if there is any strategy that establish an emotional link between the locals here and all the museums that are going to be built here. Because, you know, art is not just a beautiful painting. It's a reflection of a history. It's a reflection of culture. So for a local to go and visit a Guggenheim Museum, it will be very subjective. Just a beautiful painting. I will just go and watch. I don't know all the rich thing behind it. So is there a strategy for that?
The question I want to repeat briefly, because I want to make sure everyone heard it, is there a strategy, the question was, for making it possible, really facilitating the connection of local people here, I think you mean Emirati people particularly, but maybe also long-term residents, to these new museum developments and what is offered there, to really facilitate an understanding of the potential of those objects. And what I'd like to suggest, if it's all right with you, certainly there may be opinions here, there may be also people in the audience who might want to respond to that question. I think it is such a vital one. We have very important members from the community here who might want to speak to this. So I want people to give people an opinion. If you want to raise your hand, if you'd like to weigh in on this particular question. There in the middle, yeah.
Thank you. Ege Yildirim from Abu Dhabi Authority for Culture and Heritage, ADAJ, the same institution that Dr. Zeki belongs to. Actually, I don't feel authorized to answer you, but I could perhaps suggest a better answer from Dr. Zeki. We always talk...
Answer.
Sorry? Well, I'll start maybe if you'd like to add to it. We usually talk about the Saadiyat Island spectacular museums, but ADAJ is also... preparing a lot of museums in the pipeline. Perhaps it's too early to mention them, and perhaps sometimes the conception that ADAJ and ADTA, TDIC are working separately is overcome and we start to talk about them together. I think Dr. Zeki is more authorized to perhaps talk about these museums in detail, but we have the Bedouin Museum coming up, the Arab Contemporary Art Museum coming up, and these are things which are especially striving to catch that local spirit and heritage and, you know, the community identity concepts especially. So I think we need to talk about these in the future as they are ready. They're not perhaps ready yet.
Thank you for your clarification from the Abu Dhabi Authority for Culture and Heritage. I think we have talked about that a little bit today, the importance that this interest in heritage have long existed. With permission, I'd like to ask, though, I believe that your question was actually not just about the connection to local heritage, but to these new museums and objects. Am I correct? Would anyone like to speak to that? The question of the info? Yes, Mrs. Hodakano. Please, Mrs. Hoda, the microphone.
My name is Huda Kanu. I'm a member of ADASH as well, and I'm the founder of Abu Dhabi Music and Arts Foundation. And the lady from Suruh, your question was, is there a strategy to let you to know about the arts that's going to be in the Guggenheim, or what the Guggenheim Museum is, what the Louvre Museum is, why we're having this, and the whole, this is, if I understood from you, it's the strategy. Is there a strategy to enlighten you and enlighten the local people in Abu Dhabi? What is there? Who are the artists? What are the painting? To my knowledge, the strategy of Abu Dhabi Vision for this is in education, and it's in passing on information, is in al-ma'rifa, is to let the people know what is it about. This is what New York University is trying to do here. This is what we are trying to do in ADMAF through our many programs that we send to universities, to schools. And I think very soon with Majlis Abu Dhabi Ta'limi, headed by Al-Khayli, you're going to have this, inshallah, as well, more the arts education at the universities that would make you later on enjoy the arts that would exist in these museums. And in this, there's another part that I think would be very important for you. In our cultural and heritage, there are many of our young nationals and locals who don't know about our own culture and heritage. And this will also be integrated, inshallah, soon. And it's part of Abu Dhabi Vision. And I think this is the strategy that we are following in Adash, and as you know, member of the community, it's the strategy of the vision of Abu Dhabi, how to let you be part of all that and enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. There's also a comment on this at the very back, Reinhard Falkenberg. Thank you, Hoda.
Thank you. Perhaps NYU Abu Dhabi could also make a small contribution by thinking about helping to create an, what I'd like to call an experimental exhibition design space, which might be offered in commonality with other authorities, with the authorities here and with participating museums. A facility where one could test out different types of exhibitions in close conjunction indeed with the educational partners here in Abu Dhabi, so that audiences and exhibition makers, people who offer information, work closely together to test out the different types of exhibitions that people here in Abu Dhabi would really like to see, exhibitions that could actually come from all over the world.
Thank you very much. That was the Dean of Arts and Humanities at New York University Abu Dhabi. So anyone who's interested in this, please speak to him, because he will help make it happen.
Can I then just make a general comment here, which is that there is a strategy, I believe, in every cultural development in Abu Dhabi and in the Emirates to integrate that into the community through education, through training, and through bringing more out to the community itself. So this is happening. Now, what it does, it takes time. I do not believe that this is possible to achieve this in a year or two. It takes time. But what I want to say, my personal feeling about this, is that none of our projects will have any meaning unless they are integrated into our community. Because all these projects are built around the concept that it is for the Emirati society first, to bring education and training to the young people, to the elderly people, to the older generation as well, and then subsequently to everybody else around us. So I believe that without doing this, if we do not succeed in this, or if those who are in charge of our different projects do not succeed in this, then the projects will not have been successful.